My name is Lisa Balsero with USF Health. Thank you so much for joining us today as we continue our Facebook Live series in health and wellness. And this month, June, is actually Men's Health Awareness Month. And I'm delighted to be here today with Dr. John Dunning. Thank you so much for being here.
Hello, Lisa. How are you?
Great. Dr. Dunning is recently here at USF Health from the UK, so we're extra excited to have you come all this way over to Tampa Bay to be our heart and lung transplant surgeon and cardiothoracic surgeon here at FAC Surgery, aligned with USF Health and Tampa General Hospital. So, Dr. Dunning, coming all this way over to Tampa, what strikes you as an area that you're most passionate about coming here to do heart surgery?
Well, Lisa, I've been involved with heart surgery for about 27 years now. And for most of that time, I've been involved in heart and lung transplantation. And one of the exciting things coming to this unit is the size of the heart-lung transplant program. And that gives a really good clinical basis for a safe, secure service. And it also gives us a platform from which we can work in clinical research to develop new advances and new therapies within the field of transplantation. And in this group, there are a lot of physicians who are also interested in carrying forward research in this area. So it's an exciting opportunity to come here and be part of it.
Excellent. We're really delighted to have you here. So I understand that in the UK there was a procedure that you did along with the pulmonary department that is a little more unique, and you did hundreds of those in the UK, but in the United States there's only a select hospitals are doing those. Are you going to be bringing that here to Tampa General, hopefully?
Well, it's certainly one of the things that we've discussed. The operation is called a pulmonary end arteriectomy, and it's for a small group of patients who have pulmonary hypertension. And it's secondary to chronic thromboembolic disease. So these are patients who've had pulmonary emboli in the past. Mm-hmm. The embolus has failed to resolve, and it results in obstruction of the pulmonary arteries. It's a physical obstruction, and it can be removed at open heart surgery. The techniques are quite advanced. We need to use circulatory arrest and profound hypothermia to protect the patient's cerebral function. And then we can operate inside the pulmonary arteries for periods of 20, 25 minutes at a time and remove the physical obstruction. As I say, there are not many centers in the United States doing this operation, certainly not in significant numbers. But the unit I came from in the UK, which was Papworth Hospital in Cambridge, I developed a program which serves the whole country, and we were doing around 170 or 180 of these procedures every year there.
Wow. Well, how long did it take to get that program up to the level that you wanted to?
We started it in 1996, and in the first year I did 6 operations. The second year I did 1, and from there onwards it got rather bigger. And quite quickly we grew to around 50 operations a year. And then I think over the last decade it has just increased. And we're at the stage there now where we take patients from other countries in Europe and other countries outside Europe as well who don't have the service.
Wow, that's impressive. An area that we have at Tampa General Hospital and USF Health is the structural heart program, where there's different team members with imaging and interventional cardiologists. Where do you see that you fall into that, and tell us about that team effort that we have here at USF?
Well, I think the face of cardiac surgery has changed tremendously. As I said, I've been involved in it for about 30 years now. And in probably over the last decade, we've done much more collaborative work with other disciplines, other specialties within the hospital. And the technology that's available to us now in terms of being able to replace valves or manipulate valves percutaneously using catheter-based technology has grown significantly. Also, with the advanced imaging teams and the vascular teams, we're doing more endovascular stenting of things like the descending thoracic aorta, even beginning to be able to move into aortic arch stenting and ascending aortic stenting, all using endovascular technology. From the point of view of the patient, the benefit this may offer is that they have a shorter recovery period. Obviously, the procedure is less invasive and much less of a physical assault to them. And so it sets the scene probably for a more complete and hopefully for a more rapid recovery.
Excellent. And also giving more folks access if they weren't able to have open heart surgery, then there are other types of procedures that they may be able to do?
Well, certainly that's part of it. And I think as cardiac surgery has become more established, it's still a young specialty. So the first heart valve replacement operation was 1963. The first successful coronary artery bypass surgery was in the 1966, 1967. And so it's a young specialty. It's grown very, very rapidly. It's heavily technology based. And as we've grown, we've extended the range of indications for surgery, moving into patients who are older, who have greater numbers of comorbidities. And the catheter-based technology offers us opportunity to operate in patients that we might consider too high risk for conventional open heart surgery.
Gotcha, okay. And then, as it's Men's Health Month, do you have any sort of more basic advice for folks? I know that, you know, obviously diet, exercise, anything else that you...
Well, of course, maintaining a healthy diet, a balanced diet, not going to extremes, but a balanced diet is an important thing, accompanied by a useful exercise regimen, taking a moderate amount of exercise every day, perhaps 10 or 15 minutes of moderate pace walking is a good thing for everybody to do. Mm. But even more importantly than that, I think, is that for men who smoke, to stop smoking. We start at a disadvantage as a man. We have 10 times the incidence of coronary artery disease in males compared to the female population. If a woman smokes, she will increase her risk of coronary artery disease by 10 and bring it up to the level of a non-smoking man. If a man smokes, he multiplies his risk as well. And so the basic message must be stop smoking.
Yeah, that makes sense. So Michelle, did we have any questions come in from our viewers?
I think one of the questions that we'd have is about technology and how technology has helped save more lives, say in the past 10 years, as opposed to a surgery that could have been done maybe in 2000 or 2008, and that surgery being done now. Is there something different being done or more lives being saved by technology?
Well, technology adds to it. The simplest thing that we've done, which has improved our outcomes, is started to monitor them much more closely. And with thorough audit programs, analyzing our outcomes and the results of our surgery, we've already been able to drive down some of the risk factors for cardiac surgery. Having said that, there have been developments in the cardiopulmonary bypass technology, in the technology that we use for valve implantation, which means that we're able to do so in a much safer way for patients today, often with shorter duration of operations, and we've been able to extend the indications for surgery as well, so that we operate on a wider pool of patients, even those who have established comorbidities.
Excellent. So thank you so much for your time today, Dr. Dunning.
Thank you, Lisa. It's been a pleasure, and it's great to be here in Tampa.
Thank you.